In this video, we'll add Firebase Analytics into our application. Hey guys, welcome back to episode 7 of the free Firebase and Flutter course. For most of my tutorials, I try and focus on making the code maintainable and keeping the code base healthy. For this video, I wanna add the analytics because it's something that we can use to make sure that our code and our application is still healthy while being used in production by the real users. This tutorial, as well as all the others, comes with a starting code where we have set up the Firebase connection and some other things. Head over to fullstacks.com where you can download the starting code for this project. Once you've downloaded the code, you can open it up in your IDE. And the first thing we'll do, as always, is get all the packages for the project. Then we can go ahead and start the implementation of adding the Firebase analytics into our codebase. We'll start with adding in the package, which is called Firebase Analytics, and we'll use version 5.0.11. Once the package has been fetched, we can go over to the services folder, where we will create a new file called Analytics Service. Then in this file, we'll create a new class called Analytics Service. We'll start off by storing a final reference to an instance of the Firebase Analytics class. We'll make it a private variable called Analytics. And then we'll also add a function that returns a Firebase Analytics Observer. This function will be called getAnalyticsObserver. It will create a new instance of the Firebase Analytics Observer and pass the private analytics instance into the constructor. Then we can open up the locator file where we can register our service with a getit instance. We'll register the analytics service as a lazy singleton. Now adding in the Firebase package, you'll get some basic analytics like the startup time and user interactions. One of the most important things to track is the page views that the user is navigating to. Flutter and Firebase makes this quite easy by allowing us to place navigation observers into our material app. We'll supply a new list of navigator observers. Then we'll get the analytics service from the locator where we'll get the analytics observer from the function that we just created. The analytics observer will be called automatically whenever we navigate within the app. It will make use of the name property on the settings object and it will log these values as the page being navigated to and navigated from. When you're using named routing, like with this tutorial that I'm linking in the top corner, you won't have to make any changes because the name of the settings argument is already set. But if you are using the navigator and passing the material route directly, you'll have to make some changes for the analytics observer to be able to log the screens that you are navigating to. This is not a very big change, but basically everywhere where you navigate using the material page route directly, you have to now supply settings for that material page route and construct a new route settings where you set the name of that settings object. This will be the name that will show up in the analytics console when you navigate between views. The analytics traditionally takes a few hours and sometimes even a day or two to sync onto your backend. Firebase has provided a tab called Debug View where you can in real time see what the debug applications are doing on your phone so that you can start to see what events are being logged. These events are blocked by default on all devices so we don't send up the analytics while using a debug build. To fix this, you have to set a debug Firebase Analytics app on the phone by using the adb commands. You can type in adb shell setprop debug.firebase.analytics.app and you will basically set this property for a specific package name. And in our case, the package is called com.fullstacks.compound. You can go ahead and put that as the final parameter and then press enter in the terminal. Once this has been run, your device will now send up the debug analytics for that specific package. You can open up the Firebase console and head over to the analytics section on the left side. You'll see the last entry into the analytics category is called debug view. That's where you'll see the devices connected and the events that has been fired off. And if you run this app now and you open up the Firebase console, you'll see that all the events will show up within a timeline that you can click on and inspect. This is a very useful view to see which events are being logged on your side, which will ensure that you log in the correct events with the correct variable values. So if you click on one of these events, you'll see all of the parameters that are being passed in, and the Firebase screen will be the parameter that has the actual name of the view. We also have the Firebase previous screen, which will tell you the screen that it came from before landing on this current view. Then in the top right of this view, you'll see a top events category where you can click on the Firebase screen parameter, where it'll now show you all of the entries into that parameter itself. You can see all the views that you've navigated to and where you came from. The next important thing for me is usually to make sure that we can track one specific user's journey through our app. To do this, we will set the user ID and we'll also make use of some custom user properties to make sure we know what the user is. You can open up the analytics service and we'll add a new function called set user properties. This function will take in a required string called user ID. In the body of this function, we will await the call to the analytics function called setUserID and we'll pass in the user ID from the parameters. This value will have to be set whenever we log in or sign up or just open up the app after we've logged in already. You can head over to the authentication service where we will put this call in the populate user function as well as the sign up function. So at the top of the authentication service, we'll create a new final reference to the analytics service, which we'll get from our locator. Then you can scroll down to the populate current user function. And then after we get the current user and set that value, we will await on the set user properties call and we'll pass in the user.uid to the user ID value. Then we can go ahead and copy that line of code. And in the sign in function, after we create a Firestore user, we will now set the user ID equal to the auth result.user.uid. The next thing we want to know is what role the user was when they signed up or when they log in for any of the sessions. We'll add a new parameter to the set user properties function called user role. Then we'll add a new call to the analytics service using the set user property function. This takes in a name which we'll set to user underscore role and a value which we'll set to the user role being passed in. You can think of it this way. The user properties tell us what the user is and the user events tell us what the user is doing. Having these user properties will allow us to create audiences based on specific features or functionalities that we know this user is using. You can always add additional properties, things like a paying user or a pro member. And then you can also internally start adding some properties that you can monitor using cloud functions for things like a regular poster or someone that logs in and never posts. This will allow you to target these users using audiences in the Firebase Analytics console. Back in the authentication service, we can now pass in the user role where we are setting our user properties. The user role can be accessed by indexing into the current user user role property. We can do the same thing in the populate current user function. When you add a custom user property, you have to tell Firebase console that you are using that. So in the analytics tab on the left side, you'll see a user properties tab. Click on that and then select create first property. For the property name, we will set it equal to the value we gave it, which will be user underscore role. And in the description, you can type whatever you want to describe to yourself what this key is representing as your user property. This will now allow you to go over to the audiences tab where you can create a custom audience for all of the users that are registered for that specific topic. You'll find your custom properties under the registered role and then you can just say what it contains or what it is equal to. We will not go over any of the audience creation since that is a complete course that could be done on its own. Now we can get on to adding the actual information that can tell us what our users are doing within the app. To do a good job with this, it's a lot like having good logs within your code base. You have to define the things that you want to know and why you would want to know it, and then you log specific things to tell you the story of the actions that you would like to be tracking within the app. So because this app is so small, we don't have a lot of things to log. So what we'll do is we want to know when a user signs up. We want to know what role they chose. We also want to know when a user logs in, as well as when a user creates a post and if they are using an image for that post or not. We'll start off with a login event logs. Head over to the analytics service and create a new function called log login. The body of this function will simply call the log login function on the analytics instance and will supply a login method and give it a value of email. Once you have multiple authentications, you can then change this value based on the authentication service, which will allow you to make audiences based on what type of login the user has used. Then you can head over to the login view model, where we will now call this log login function. We'll start off by getting a final reference to the analytics service at the top using the locator to get the analytics service. Then in the login function, where we know the result is now a success, we will call the log login function before we navigate to the home view route. Next up, we'll do sign in. You can open up the analytics service file and we will create a new function called log sign up. The body of this function will call the log sign up function and provide a sign up method of type email. Then you can head over to the sign up view model. We'll get a reference to the analytics service from the locator. And when the sign up has been a success, before we navigate to the home view route, we will call the log sign up function on the analytics service. The last thing I want to cover is creating a custom event. Go back to the analytics service, where we will create a new function called log post created. We will pass in an additional boolean called hasImage. Then in the body of this function, we will call the log event function. This call will take in a name that we will set to create underscore post, and we'll also pass in parameters to this function call. The parameters takes a map with a key string and a value of type dynamic. We'll set a new value called has underscore image, and we'll pass in the boolean has image value to that key. The Firebase library provides you with multiple events that you can choose from. There's everything from add payment info to add campaign details to post score to logging a search to present offers. They almost cover everything that you would require. But I just wanted to go over the custom events so that you can know how to add your own events in the case you need to. Now we can head over to the create post view model, where we will get a final reference to the analytics service from the locator. And after a post has been successful, we will now await on that call and we will log post created and pass in the has image property value. This value will be determined by checking if the selected image is not equal to null. And that is basically everything I wanted to cover. I'm not going to continue doing this process because you're simply just adding functions and then adding the calls where you want to be logging those events. Having these analytics events to produce metrics for yourself will help you to increase the usage of your app. It will help you to improve the UI of your applications because you can see where the users are falling off. It will also help you to debug problems in the live environment. Similar to logging, I think this is a very important part of application development. That's going to be all for this week. I hope you guys enjoyed it, and I'll see you guys next week.